everyone's safety. So we would, I know the staff and the board and the leadership of the church would just really appreciate as, you know, cooperate with us on as much as you can with that. So thank you for your cooperation. We're going to open up in the word of prayer. I'm glad that we're able to come and just to worship him. Amen? That was a little weak. I'm glad that we're able to come and worship him. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. I do want to say hi to someone very special to my heart. That's my wife, Jenny. Hi, Jenny. I had to do that. She's watching online at home with the kids. And that she will be coming back to the service, but she's going to just give it a little while before she comes back just to help build her immune system up and everything else is going and that. So she's joining us online as many other people are. So let's, why don't we stand and let's just open up in the word of prayer and just give our this time of worship to the Lord. So Father, we thank you for the privilege and the honor of worshiping you. Father, I'm thankful that you are God, that you are in control, and that, Father, you are awesome. So, Father, we give this time of worship into your hands. Lord, let the anointing of the Holy Spirit rest upon the team as they lead us in worship. We thank you and we praise you. We commit our time this morning, both in person, if there's anyone in the parking lot, Father, those watching online. Father, let your spirit just permeate into our hearts, into our homes, into our cars, wherever we might find ourselves. And, Father, may when all is said and done, may we say what David said. I was glad to be in the house of the Lord. Father, we give this time into your hands. Father, touch us. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said amen and amen. Abigail, why don't you lead us in some worship?
Good morning. We'll stand up and praise the Lord.
Sing like never before.
up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the for my heart to find. Oh, bless the light on my soul. Oh, my soul, worship His holy name and sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship Your draws near and my time has come. Still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul, worship His holy. Before I spoke a word, You were singing over me. And You've been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, You breathed Your life in me. And You've been so, so kind to me. And all the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God, oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still You give Yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love. Your foe, stay love far from me. You've been so, so good to me. I felt no worthy, You paid it all for me. You've been so, so kind to me. And all the you shiny won't light. I'm out and you won't climb up, coming after me. The snow wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. So shiny won't light. I'm out and you won't climb up, coming after me. The snow wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. The snow shiny. Atmosphere is changing now. For the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here. Overflowing this place, fill our hearts with your love surrounds us. You're the reason we came to encounter your love surrounds us. The atmosphere is changing now, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here. Overflow in this place. Fill our hearts with your love surrounds us. You're the reason we came to encounter your love surrounds us. Overflow in this place, fill our hearts with of God, for forever. hearts with your love. Your love surrounds us. You're the reason we came to encounter your love. Your love surrounds us. A miracle can happen now. For the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around. For the Spirit of the Lord is here. A miracle can happen now. For the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around. And the Spirit of the Lord is here. Overflow in this place. Fill our hearts with your love. Your love surrounds us. You're the reason we came to encounter your love. Your love surrounds us. Overflow in this place. Fill our hearts with your love. Your love surrounds us. You're the reason we came to encounter your love surrounds us. Spirit of God, fall fresh on us. We need your presence. Your kingdom come, your will be.
I don't know what you need today. I don't know what battles you might be facing, whether here in person. If you're in one of our parking lots or you're watching us online, I don't know what battle you might be facing. There's a very powerful spiritual truth. Thank you so much for doing that song. That's an awesome. I love that song. I'm going to get you in a minute to sing that verse that says, a miracle can happen here, and then go into the chorus. It says, here as in heaven, the Bible says in Matthew chapter 18, whatsoever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatsoever you loose on earth will be loose in heaven. What that actually means is that what you do not permit to happen. And when you take authority that God has given to you, if you are a believer, you have the authority of the Holy Spirit and the power of the Holy Spirit to take charge over the circumstances and the situations in your life. The enemy would lie to you and say, no, you're going to lose this battle. But God comes along and says, whatever you will say, it stops here. The line is drawn here. The enemy comes this far and no further. In my life, my finances, my healing, my body, my family, my kids, my job, whatever it is, you have the authority. You don't need me to do it for you. You have just as much authority and power as any pastor or evangelist on the face of this planet. I don't care if you've been saved for a million years or you just got saved last week. You have the authority. You just need to acknowledge that authority and appropriate it. So if you sit there and you got a situation happening in your life and you need a miracle and the enemy's lying to you, you can sit there and say, no, it stops here. Enemy, you've had your way long enough. No farther. I'm drawing the line. Then what happens is the Holy Spirit comes along and says, we will back you. Heaven will back you with all the hosts of heaven. I've seen that. And then whatever you loose on earth, whatever you allow, whatever you permit to happen will be loosed in heaven. So I don't know what you might be facing. As our faces are different, so are the needs we face every single day. And today's need may not be tomorrow's need. I just want to take a couple moments. I want Abigail to lead that verse that says, a miracle can happen here. I want you to sing that verse a couple times if you can in just a moment. So whatever miracle you have, whatever you need God to do for you today, I first want to ask this. How many here by a show of hands believe that God is a God of miracles? Okay, let me see your hand if you believe it. Hold it up. Okay. You guys have walked through with my family since 2019 and some of the things we've gone through, and you've seen the power and the miracles of God. My family is a living testimony of miracle can happen in this place. Time after time after time. And he's no respecter of persons. You need a miracle today. As we sing this, I want you to declare. I'm going to be sharing something in just a few moments. I want to change the way you maybe do your prayer life. How many have been asking God for a miracle? Let me see your hands. You've been asking God for a miracle. Today, I want you to decree it that it is happening now. The Bible says to call into being those things that are not as though they are. You have the authority to do that. And I'm going to explain to you exactly how that works this morning. So could you lead us in that? And whatever miracle you have, whatever need you have, as the worship team leads us in that verse, do it twice and then the chorus again. As they do that, I want you to say this. Father God in heaven, I decree in the name of Jesus that my son, my daughter, my husband, my wife is returning back in faith. Father in heaven, I decree in the name of Jesus, according to your word, that my family member who is sick with sickness is now walking in complete healing and wholeness. Father, I declare in the name of Jesus that my financial struggles are going to be over because your word says you will supply my every need, not my greed, not my necessarily, but my needs. And in the name of Jesus, you said you will provide what I need. So I decree in the name of Jesus that miracle coming to pass. I want you to stop asking for it for a moment and start speaking it that it already is happening. That's calling into being those things that are not as though they are. Speak to that miracle and call it forth. Sing that verse for us.
A miracle can happen now. For the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around that the Spirit of the Lord is here.
Sing that again. A miracle can happen.
A miracle can happen now. For the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around. Then the Spirit of the Lord is here.
Sing it a third time. A miracle can happen.
A miracle can happen.
Call into being right now, Father.
For the Spirit of the Lord.
The power of the Holy Spirit.
The evidence is all around. Then the Spirit of the Lord.
Sing that chorus, Spirit of the Living God.
Holy Spirit. This place, fill our hearts with your love surrounds us. You're the reason we came to encounter your love surrounds us. Overflow in this place, fill our hearts with your love. Your love surrounds us. You're the reason we came to encounter your love. Your love surrounds us.
Now, Father, in the name of Jesus, we remind you of your word. Father, as people are claiming the promises that are in the written word every single time, Father, your word says, I'm reminded of the time that when Jesus walked on this earth that the people thronged him. He healed all their diseases. When there was a need for food, he provided food. When there was a need for finances, he provided that. So God, we believe in a God of miracles today. And Father, our worship and our praise as we give to you, Lord, sets the atmosphere, Father, for us to walk in your Spirit. So God, I pray, whatever your people need today, that Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, that you would meet them at their point of need, whatever it is. And God, I take the authority that you've given. And your word says in Matthew 18 that whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatsoever you loose on earth will be loose in heaven. And Father, I bind fear and doubt in the name of Jesus. Take authority over it. Every principality, every spiritual wickedness, regardless of their rank and their position, we command you to be cast into the sea and to not return in the name of Jesus. You are defeated. You have no control. You have no power. Father, I lose faith, confidence. Let the presence of God, the Holy Spirit, permeate every mind, every heart, of every family, every home in this congregation. Whether they're here today or not, whether they're here in person or in watching online or wherever they might find themselves, Father, that faith would rise up in Jesus' name. That fear and doubt would be gone in the name of Jesus. And faith would rise up. Father, birth in your people a desire, a yearning, a longing to get into the Word, to know the Word, to know the truth, to know who they are as a believer, They are the head, they're not the tail. They are conquerors, more than conquerors in Christ Jesus. You've given us everything available to us to walk through every challenge. Sometimes, Father, you remove the challenge away from us. Sometimes when we speak to the mountain is removed. Sometimes, Father, you take us by the hand and say, we're going to go through this mountain together. Father, I think of the story when Jesus said to the disciples, let's get in the boat and cross to the other side, and the storm hit. They were in the perfect will of God. Yes, storm hit, and Father, fear rose in their hearts. The agenda, the destination of Jesus did not change. The circumstances may look like all was lost, but all he did was stand up and speak to the storm. Father, speak to the storm in people's lives today. Let faith rise up in them. Father, as we look into your word, we ask you, Father, that you would speak to us through your word. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear and a heart that would be open to what your spirit would say to us today. And we thank you and we praise you. For we ask you this in no other name but in the name of Jesus, and everyone said amen. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you, worship team. Amen.
Imagine a room. Walls around you. It's uncomfortable. It's stagnant. It's hard to breathe. There's a pressure on your chest. You can feel the weight of the world holding you there. You can't escape it. Everything about the room stays the same, but it feels smaller with each passing day. And you can remember a life where this room wasn't familiar. You were the one on the outside looking in, but something happened, and now you're here. There are chains around you that you can't seem to break. You feel powerless, and your thoughts are so loud that you can't hear the truth. This is fear, and fear is a liar. This darkness can't last. There is a light that cuts through chains made of steel and walls made of stone. When we grab onto this light, it pulls us up, breaks us free from the grasp of this darkness. The momentum builds beneath us. We can stand, we can run, we can live in freedom. There is a voice that drowns out the lies. There is a peace that stills the chaos. And his name is Jesus.
His name is Jesus. Fear is one of the most powerful weapons that the enemy will use to get us and hold us captive. If you have your Bibles, I'm going to ask you to turn to Daniel chapter 6. We're starting verse 1 in just a few moments. And as we're finding our way there, today I want to begin a very short series, a three-part series entitled Fearless. This series is designed to give you a cup of courage. This series is for people that whose courage tank has maybe sprung a leak. I've asked people, where do you and when do you need courage? The Bible tells us that are people, men and women, who are just like you and I, Like we think some of these people are superstars, superheroes. They're not. They're people like you and I, just ordinary individual people like you and I who somehow got a hold of the Holy Spirit, or the Holy Spirit got a hold of them, and they had courage to do different things. We're going to look at Daniel. We're going to look at Esther. We'll look at David, and we'll see people from different backgrounds as well. So if you have your Bibles, let's look at Daniel chapter 6, verse 1. And we're going to jump around a couple of verses there. And if you have your Bible, I want to encourage you to bring your Bibles each week, whether on your smart device or on your, like, remember those ones that had pages? Remember them years ago? Bring them. I like the backlit ones as well. So just don't play solitaire while the message going on your smart device. Verse 1, it pleased Darius to set over the kingdom 120 satraps to be throughout the whole kingdom, and over them three high officials, of whom Daniel was one, to whom these satraps would give an account, so that the king might suffer no loss. Then Daniel became distinguished above all of the other high officials and satraps, because an excellent spirit was in him. Isn't it interesting? Daniel was a captive from his home country into Babylon as a prisoner of war, a spoil of war in a foreign country, religiously oppressed, yet he stands out above everyone else because of the spirit in him. And the king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. Then the high officials and the satraps who sought to find a ground for complaint against Daniel regard to the kingdom, but they could not find no ground or complaint or any fault because he was faithful and no error or fault was found in him. Can you imagine having that testimony? The place that you work at, people sit there and say, I can't find anything wrong with that individual. I can't find no fault. Like, if you want to find fault with me, you don't have to go far. Just text one of my kids and they'll send you a document. But this man of God, this young man, as God moved in his life, verse 5, then these men said, we shall not find any ground for complaint against Daniel unless we find a connection with the law of his God. Notice they said his God. Verse 6, then these high officials and satraps came by agreement to the king, said to him, O King Darius, live forever. Again, you see the scene. O King Darius, live forever. Talk about sucking up. All the high officials of the kingdom and the prefects and the satraps and the counselors and the governors are agreed that the king should establish an ordinance and enforce an injunction that whoever makes a petition to any other man, any other god, for 30 days, except you, playing in on the king's ego, O king, shall be cast into the lion's den. Now, O king, establish the injunction and sign the document so it cannot be changed according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which cannot be revoked. Therefore, King Darius signed the document and the injunction. Verse 10. When Daniel knew the document had been signed, he went to his house where he had windows in his upper chamber towards Jerusalem. He got down on his knees three times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God as he had done previously. Nothing changes with this Daniel. Verse 16. Then the king commanded, and Daniel was brought forth and cast into the den of lions. And the king declared to Daniel, may your God whom you serve continually deliver you. And a stone was brought and laid at the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet and with the signet of his lords, that nothing might be changed concerning Daniel. Then the king went to his palace and spent the night fasting. No diversions were brought to him, and sleep fled from him. See, King Darius didn't want to do this because King Darius liked Daniel. But he was caught between a rock and a hard place. Then at the break of day, the king rose, in verse 19, and went in haste to the den of the lions and came near to the den where Daniel was. He cried out in tone of anguish. The king declared to Daniel, O Daniel, servant of the living God, has your God whom you serve continually been able to deliver you from the lions? And then Daniel said to the king, O king, live forever. My God has sent an angel and shut the lion's mouth, and They have not harmed me because I was found blameless before him, and I, as I am also before you, O king, I have done no harm. Then the king was exceedingly glad and commanded that Daniel be taken up from the lion's den. So Daniel was taken up from the lion's den, and no harm, no kind of harm was found on him because he had trusted in his God. If you read on a little bit longer in that story, you find out they took those same men who laid the trap for Daniel, threw them in the lion's den, and before their bodies hit the ground, they were devoured into pieces. See, when evil plans to control and to corrupt, their plans always backfire on them. This is one of the most enduring, well-known stories in the Bible and all of literature. Daniel teaches us how to live when you are when you believe in the one true God in the world where moral compass is actually broken. Our world moral compass is broken, same as it was then. For the few next moments, I want to for you to see how God can give us courage to live out our convictions. Daniel, like Daniel, we've been placed in a world of worry and fear. Everything that's been happening for years, not just with COVID-19, but years, has been to push people to live in fear and terror. A world very different than the one we grew up in, a world that is evolving quickly. We live in a very challenging world. In this series, I wanted to dedicate it to help you find your courage to live for Christ, even in this broken world. And just so you know, this world is not going to get any better. I want you to see Daniel as a living, breathing example of what Proverbs 28, verse 1 says, "The wicked flee when no one pursues, but the righteous are as bold as a lion." God doesn't want believers to shrink back and to hide in the shadows. He wants us to be bold as a lion. He wants us to be the salt of the earth, the light of the world, and to shine forth. So if you're taking notes, I have 3 points, a couple of little sub-points in there. If you're taking notes, the first one is fear and its friends. Because fear by itself never comes alone. The enemy is a bully. And he will bully you into a corner. He will bully you until he gets you to back down. Don't let him bully you into that situation. Fear and its friends. The world is a scary place, whether it's random shootings or threat of COVID restrictions, more lockdowns, government control. Many of us are scared like we've never been before. And violence is erupting all over the world, everywhere. There isn't a follower of Christ who doesn't at some time struggle to reconcile what he knows about God and about the challenges that he faces. Often when our faith and our culture collides, fear can sometimes seize us. Fear can cause us to shrink where our courage should swell. Fear can cause you to sit and say nothing and do nothing. See, our story began with a breakdown of administration of government of the Persian Empire. Our political arena, not just in Canada or the States, everywhere is in upheaval. I think we can all agree to that. That's why we need to be praying for those that are in government. We need to be praying for them and asking God to give them a godly understanding that they can rule whatever nation they are a part of with godly principles. This was the largest empire in the world history at this time, and Daniel was chosen and promoted at the expense of others. In today's story, we see a number of high officials or government officials who feared losing control by an outsider. Daniel was an outsider. Here he comes in, and King Darius saying, "I like you. I like what you do. I like what you stand for. I like the gifts and the talents you have. I'm going to make you a high ruler." It doesn't sit very well. He's the new kid on the block, and yet he's been given all this control. Let's look at what motivated these high officials for a moment. Jealousy and anger, the two friends of fear. As an enemy will concentrate their fire on their best soldier, so did these high officials. They chose Daniel to concentrate their jealousy. They were jealousy, and as an ant swarms honey after a picnic, Daniel attracted these men's jealousy like honey. Jealousy is one of the most horrible things that can control and destroy someone's life. And they were jealous. Fear leading to frustration. Fear travels in packs just like a wolf. Only these men's fears might be the best way to describe them as paranoid. These high officials, they were losing control. And fear motivated them to conspire against Daniel. And here's something I've noticed. A cheap substitute for courage is anger. And anger is often fueled by fear. One is angry and frustrated when one cannot control the events of one's life. Anger fuels one's paranoia. The irony of this is this. They thought they were controlling the situation. But in the essence, they were being controlled. They were being controlled by a power of darkness. Remember this, evil can never manufacture enough glue to keep itself together. Evil plans have no lasting cohesions, and evil plans will always dissolve. Every plan the enemy tries to bring against the godly will come to naught because his kingdom is divided against itself. Taking notes, number two, the fundamentals of courage. Where does courage come from? How do you get courage when you need it? Some are born with personalities and dispositions that exude self-assurance. There's people that it just beams from them. Yet for most of us, confidence has to be developed over time. But courage is more than a feeling good about yourself. I've been preaching for about 30 years, in ministry for about 30 years. I was sharing with someone today that when I started leading worship and started preaching, I remember my first sermon, I was so nervous. In this church, it was a Word of Faith church, you had to preach for an hour. Now, I'm not going to preach for an hour today. But yeah, preach for an hour. And my brother James helped me with a message that did. My first sermon was Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. And I remember I had page upon page upon page. I was so nervous. I did an hour-long message in 5 minutes. Remember the first time I was leading worship at a piano, it was this baby grand piano that had two mics on it. It was a bigger church. All you heard was this. That was my knee hitting the bottom of the piano. I didn't have the courage that I have now. That took time. When God called me into the ministry, I said, "Are you out of your mind?" I didn't have the courage. But through the power of the Holy Spirit, it developed over the years. Not everyone's born with those personalities that exude from them. Most of us have to develop and work hard at them. Look with me at Daniel's prayer. Look at his spirit. In verse 3, it says, "Then Daniel became distinguished above all the other officials because an excellent spirit was in him, and the king planned to set him over the entire kingdom." Daniel at this moment is approximately 88 years old when he stood before King Darius. Remember that Daniel is a spoil of war. He is a trophy of war, and that he was carried off to a strange land and made a slave. But look at Daniel's integrity, verse 4, the last part of it. "They could find no ground for complaint or any fault because he was faithful." Say faithful. "He was faithful, and no error or fault was found in him." In other words, in a world where kickbacks were the norm, you play our game. You compromise, you play our game, and there'll be something in it for you. In a world where kickbacks were the norm, Daniel was pure and honest. I pray and I trust that they can say that about us. Look at verse 5. Then these men said, well, we shall not find any ground for complaint against this Daniel unless we find it in connection with the law of his God. But look at Daniel's discipline. Daniel's discipline. He was consistent, constant, habit of prayer. It would have been awesome to experience and to listen outside the doorway of Daniel's prayer closet. I think it would have been amazing. Of all the spiritual disciplines a Christian does, surely prayer is the beating of the heart. And I don't think we give that enough precedence in our lives. Prayer is a sign of trust. A sign of trust in God who does and has the events of my life in control. There are times when I would be praying. Between my scheduled prayers of time, that my kids would walk into the living room. I would be sitting in my living room, and I would have the notion, I need to pray for my wife. I have music on the background when I pray. Some people like quietness. I like me. So I put YouTube worship on our TV in the living room, and I'd have it turned up, and I would just be walking back and forth in the living room. My kids would come in, and they would hear me pray. I didn't stop praying. I'd say, oh, I can't let them hear. I continued on. Continue to pray. See, it would have been awesome to hear his prayer thing. They would hear me pray. They would hear me. And let me let you in on a little secret. I'm not the quietest prayer. I mean, when I pray and I get into it, I mean, I don't need a microphone. That's not a bad thing for others to hear how you pray and cry out to God. See, Daniel, he had defiance, not in a bad way. Soon Darius issues a decree that no prayer would be for 30 days. And look at Daniel's reaction, verse 10. When Daniel knew that the document had been signed, he went to his house where he had windows in his upper chamber open towards Jerusalem. He got down on his knees three times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God as he had done previously. Nothing changes. Daniel prays the same place, at the hour, in the same position, and in the same spirit that he had done before. There was no alteration in his convictions. Daniel knew that if he were to stop praying as it was his habit, it would look like he was complying with his new decree. And he said, you can't tell me not to pray to my God. See, we need to develop and to live with biblical convictions. I think the problem today with modern Christianity and faith is that we have succumbed to what makes others feel comfortable. Praying, speaking in tongues. See, we have three choices in this world today. As a believer, you have three choices. The first one is the internal choice. Many of us look inside of us to find moral clarity. I can go with the choice that says, I'm going to believe based on what I choose to be truth. Let me put it on record to say 99.9% of the time, that will lead us astray. External choice, where we say, I believe based on what everyone else is doing. Again, that's going to lead you down the road of destruction and away from God. The third one is called the eternal choice. And I want to encourage each of us to follow this. It is God is truth. God is absolute. God is universal. And God is unchanging. Know what Daniel didn't do. Many Christians would rationalize and say, so what if I pray in secret for the next 30 days? In other words, what if I hide who I am? God doesn't want us to hide who we are. Daniel didn't look for a secret place to pray, and he didn't skip his morning and noon and night devotions. Daniel didn't pray with his window shut, and he didn't adjust his prayers according to someone else's convenience. Daniel was a lion of a man. For Daniel was a man of convictions. Friends, we need to do what's right and leave the consequences up to God. The seductive allure to compromise is a siren call that's ringing out to us. Do right and leave the consequences to God. I'm not talking about being obnoxious. I'm not talking about being rude or kind. There is a strong wind that's blowing over many of Christ's people where we don't have the courage of our convictions. We have too many people reflecting on the norms of our wicked society and calling themselves Christians. If we're going to make it through these end days, we need to live by our convictions. And our convictions have to be based upon the Word of God. Not the decrees of man, not the ideas of man, not the whims of man. The Word of God. We need Christ honoring, Bible-saturated people who lead the charge. We need to create a culture where no one goes away from their convictions. We are strangled by a consensus at times where we don't have the courage to stand alone in our convictions. Daniel didn't look for compromise. He went straight forward and continued. Number three, the focus of faith. Certainly, we feel the sleepless night of the king as he rushed to see if Daniel was torn apart by the lions. See, all of us deal with fear. There's not a single person in this auditorium this morning. There's not a single person watching us online that has not at one point dealt with fear. I'll be totally honest with you. There were times where I had to get a hold of my heart, and like David, I had to speak to my spirit. Because when my wife was going through that time where she almost died several times, I had to sit there and get hold. Because I'll be honest with you, I was afraid. We all deal with fear. All of us become fearful, discouraged, and frustrated. But someone once said, courage is being scared to death, but saddling up anyway. I like that. That's good enough to read again. Courage is being scared to death, but saddling up anyway. You see, there was something different about Daniel. He had faith. And we ask here at this point, where did Daniel get his backbone? Where was the secret of Daniel's courage? Wasn't natural. Instead, it was supernatural. So what is faith? Faith. Courage is produced by faith. And faith is God's confidence. In verse 10, he got down on his knees three times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God. He had faith in God because he personally knew that God was alive. He had a relationship. He had a history with God. He had confidence in God. And in verse 10 again, and gave thanks before his God. We need to understand, Paul tells us exactly where faith comes from in Romans chapter 10, verse 17. So faith comes from hearing. That is, hearing the good news about Christ. Or as the King James puts it, hearing by the word of God. You want your faith to grow. Get into the word. Know the word. Know the Bible. And remember in Hebrews 11, verse 6, without faith, it is impossible to please him. Daniel's faith was from above, and he had faith in God for good reason. God had never lost. God had never let him down. God remains undefeated. He has never crashed. He has never been overloaded. He has never lost a battle yet. We need to have our faith focused like a laser beam. And here are the three components you're going to need to increase your faith. Let me say this. When I was calling the hospital multiple times a day, I asked them to inform me exactly where Jenny was at that moment. I needed to know what she needed prayer for at that moment. I used the information they gave to me so I could pinpoint my prayer and target exactly what she needed right then, right now. I could do this because of three very important principles I've learned over the years.
If you want your prayer to be more effective and your faith to grow, you must understand these three important principles. And the first one is your personal experience with God. Far too many of us have borrowed faith. God is your father's God, your mom's God. Your faith belongs to them because they told you what you needed to believe. Your pastor's God. Well, I'm going to call the pastor because he has faith in God. I remember when we went through a crisis when I was a teenager. I was 14 years old, and we had three things happen within the very same year. My brother Bill got hit by a 15-ton cement block truck and almost died. The day he got out of the hospital, my father had a severe stroke and almost died. When the day he got out of the hospital, my grandmother fell and broke her hip and got pneumonia and almost died. All during those times, we were not believers at the time. We called the Catholic Church. We didn't know who else to call. We weren't Pentecostal, we didn't have any church association. So we called the church, and we didn't pray. We asked them to pray because they had faith. We didn't know what to do. It was borrowed faith. God honored that. He honored it. But too many of us have borrowed faith. What you need is God to be your God. Your relationship to be your relationship. You need to recognize there is a relationship between the strength of your faith and your personal experience with God. God is not wanting you or I to live in the shadows of someone else's faith. As great as their faith may be, it's not yours. He wants you to develop faith with him. And my purpose here as your pastor is to help you not need me. I know that sounds ridiculous. May sound weird, and may even make some of you feel uncomfortable. But he wants you to have faith in him because you know what? I don't have all the answers. Can I be totally brutally honest? I don't have most of the answers. But he does. Your parents can't be there for you all the time. Your family can't be there for you all the time. I cannot be there for you all the time. I don't have all the answers. My job is not to hold your hand through every single trial that comes your way. That's the job of the Holy Spirit, to be there for you. When Jesus told his disciples that he was leaving them, they almost couldn't bear it. But he told them that he would send another comforter, another of the same kind, the original language tells us. Each one of us, each one of you, you have the Holy Spirit. If you are a believer, the Holy Spirit lives inside of you. Whether you're filled or baptized, as we call it in the Pentecostal circles or not, you have the Holy Spirit living in you. Let me put this out there. If you do not speak in tongues, you're not filled with the Holy Spirit. You should seek the Lord so that he will fill you so that you can. See, one of the benefits I found with the Holy Spirit, being filled with the Holy Spirit, is this. Being able to speak in tongues is in Romans chapter 8, verse 26, which I use many times. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. We do not know what we should pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with God's will. See, let me throw this in there. I don't think it's in my notes, but let me throw this in for free. When you're praying in the Spirit, I mean in tongues, like that. What's happening is that the Holy Spirit is praying through you, and the Holy Spirit prays in the perfect, lined up will of God. How many of us would not want to be able to do that? Secondly, the size of your God. You need to recognize that the relationship between your strength and your faith to the size of your God. If your faith is little, and then your view of God is also small. Faith places the glory, the power, the presence of God on display for all to see it. See, all the nurses and most of the security guards at the hospital saw me walking around the building day after day after day. They saw my faith in a God who was able to heal and restore. Many of them have commented in amazement at what they saw. I didn't do it for that. I was told by one of the security guards that my consistency gave them hope. I said nothing to them. They saw that I believed that I served a big God. That in spite of what was happening in the natural, I believed that God could do something in the supernatural. What do people see when they see you? What do they see when they see you pray? Faith says God will come through. One of the biggest obstacles to possessing this type of boldness is simply people are too big and God is too small. Or at least that's what they're seeing. Fear grows when people are big and God is small. Because we think we can do it. One of the things the Holy Spirit spoke to my heart was that you are not in control of this. And remember, the Holy Spirit speaking directly to my heart that you have to either trust God or not. So what's it going to be? So I stopped praying for him to heal my wife. You're probably sitting there saying, what? I know you might be thinking, why in the world would I stop praying for her? She'll die. Don't get me wrong. I spent many, many, many hours praying, claiming scriptures, and praying for God to step in and bring her healing. But as I said, last week there was a breakthrough. And I stopped praying and started confessing she was healed and decreed that the word would be manifested in her body, mind, and spirit. I stepped it up and changed directions. There was a time to pray and cry out to God and say, God, we need you to do this. God, we need you to do that. God, we need you to intervene. And then there comes a time where we sit there and say, God, we've asked. Now we're going to declare the word of God over the situation, over the circumstances. And we're going to ask you, God, to honor your word as you said it was written. I changed directions. I changed the direction of my prayer focus on decreeing and declaring the established truth of the Word of God over her body, mind, and spirit. There is a time to ask, and then there's a time to acknowledge the established Word of truth. I knew at that moment that the Lord had heard my prayer, and now I had to step into the arena of spiritual battle. For several weeks, I prayed for healing, asking God, pleading to God for him to touch her and to heal her, to bring her back to me, to touch her body, which at this moment was becoming more and more frail. Then I spent several weeks declaring and decreeing the established word over her. I'd walk around that hospital building, and there was one section I would sit there, and I'd have my hands lifted up, and people walked by me. I got my eyes closed. I had to open a couple times so I didn't walk into people. And I'm praising God, thanking God. I'm singing songs to him. People must think I was nuts. Then there was a section that I would ask, and I'd decree, then I would quote the word of God over the situation. Standing upon the word. You need to realize that the word is more powerful than any attack from the enemy. It is more powerful than any disease, more powerful than death itself. Understand this. Was I afraid? Yes, I was afraid. But I saddled up anyway. I had no idea what he was going to do. I had no guarantees. I had to rely on him. But I knew that he was calling me to step up into a place and pray for her during a time when she couldn't. And the funny thing is, she was actually witnessing some of the battles that were taking place and actually participating in the battles while in a coma. Now, she's got some stories she's going to share with you that will blow your mind. I'll let her tell that story. Again, it will blow your mind. I like what Hebrews 10 says, yet for a little while, and the coming one will come and will not delay, but my righteous shall live by faith, and if he shrinks back, my soul will have no pleasure in him. But conversely, faith grows when God is big and people small. Let me go back to two dates. I want to close off in just a few moments here. Jenny went into the hospital on Wednesday, November 24th. Most of what happened in that time, she does not remember. Some of the COVID dreams and the coma with the medication, the drugs that she was on, she told me some of them she will share with you at a later date, some of them she won't. Like, as I said, Stephen King couldn't light a candle in some of these dreams. But let me bring you to two dates. Last week, I touched on them a little bit. She said, you should have finished the story. I said, well, I wanted to leave it for you. She said, no, you need to finish the story. So today I'm going to finish the story. I have her permission. On Monday, November 27th, Jenny was back on high flow. So for those of you that may not know what that is, regular oxygen that you get if you go into the hospital, a little bit short of breath, it's just your lungs will take it in. High flow is where they actually force it in because your lungs aren't strong enough to be able to take it in, so they force it in through you. It's not comfortable at all. It's like having a leaf blower blowing on your face. It's not very pleasant. She was on high flow at 60% oxygen and 60 liters. They were going to do, as I said, a CAT scan. I said this last week. Let me just briefly go through it again because they thought she either had blood clot in her brain, a brain aneurysm, either had several strokes, or she had severe brain damage because of delirium and confusion. She wasn't there. On Monday, the nurse told me how serious, and they were looking at reintubating her again. And as I said before, they weren't sure, but they had no other choice. They were thinking of reintubating her again on Tuesday if things didn't change and weren't sure she would survive a third intubation. They're going to do a trach. One third of both lungs were full of fluid, phlegm, mucus, whatever you want to call it. She didn't have the strength to cough it up. So she was semi-awake, doesn't remember this, thank God. They would go down her throat with suction and suck the mucus out because she couldn't. Needless to say, as I said, I didn't sleep very well that night. I prayed the entire night. Reminds me of Psalm 30, verse 5, for his anger endures but for a moment, but his favor is life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Now comes the morning. Tuesday at 6 a.m., I call again to the hospital to hear that they had decreased her level slightly, but to still very strong concern that she will relapse and need to be intubated again. I want to share something with you that Jenny has given me permission. When I called at 6 o'clock in the morning, I came down to the church at 7 and I spent an hour praying, maybe a little bit longer. And I remember crumpled on that floor, crying out to God. I stepped into warrior mode of prayer and decreed that God would speak to her and command her to wake up in the name of Jesus. I remember standing right there with the shadow of this table, right there, pointing there and saying, God, in Jesus' name, I command that you speak to her, and command her to wake up now in the name of Jesus. Only to find out that the Lord spoke to her in her spirit. And she hears a thundering voice that tells her and says, you need to wake up. You need to wake up now. And she knew. In that moment, her eyes opened. She was still confused. She had a feeding tube in. She didn't have a tube down her throat at that time. She says, I got to go to the bathroom. She started pulling the feeding tube out. My wife's a bit of a rebel. You know the center line, PICC line? It goes in your jugular. She starts pulling the tape off and pulls it out. Says, I got to get up and go to the bathroom. Now, she hasn't walked in how many days now? Gets up, falls face down. They come in. All this happened during the time I'm here declaring and decreeing the word of God over her life. In Jesus' name. I don't know if I shared this, but I will share this today. They got her up. They are surprised. They run into the room. I would too. They got her sitting up on a chair. When I called at 10 o'clock, they told me all the events of the morning and said, well, we're thinking of giving her something to eat. Now, she had to learn how to swallow and eat again. She wanted a glass of water. First time she did, she almost drowned trying to drink it because she couldn't swallow. She had to learn how to do all that again. Had to learn how to do everything. The nurse checks her chest and her lungs. Now, remember the day before, one-third of her lungs were filled with fluid, that on that day, on Monday, they were going down with suction, suctioning some of the fluid out of her lungs because she didn't have strength. They checked her lungs, the nurse gasped, her lungs are completely clear. That's what a God of miracles does. You need to shift the third thing, the eye of your faith. Need to shift your eyes from what threatens to destroy you to the one who promises to deliver you. The power of faith isn't your faith itself. The power of faith is the one you believe. Focus your faith by putting the crosshairs on Christ. Christ is the power that faith draws its strength from. Faith is sight even when the lights are off. Faith is standing there and declaring, my wife will wake up today. Because I said, God, let her wake up today. Let her be in her right mind today. Let there be no complication. By the way, the CAT scan that they were going to get for her because they thought she had brain damage, when I asked them, I don't know if I mentioned this last week, when I asked them, they said, we canceled it because there's no need for it. What's your situation today? What are you desperate for today? Have you been asking God, maybe even begging him to answer you? How about changing the direction and stand upon the established word of God? How about starting to decree the word of God over whatever situation is in front of you? You need healing? Decree that Jesus bore in his own body your sicknesses and your diseases. In his own body on the tree, and that by the strength of Jesus, you are already healed, as Peter tells us. Have financial struggles? First, make sure you're walking in obedience with tithing. Had to get that in there. And if you are, decree the word of God, and he will rebuke the devourer over you, and he will supply all of your needs in Christ Jesus. Have a family member that's not serving Jesus. Decree that the God of this world with a small g, according to Corinthians 4:4, of this world be bound, that he's been blinding them, and that your household will be saved because you believe, as Acts 16:31 tells us. I could go on all day on the promises that God gives to each one of us to apply to every area of our lives. But let me say this, stand upon the established word of God and watch what he does. And you too can live fearless. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for the word of God. I thank you that you are a God of miracles, that you are a God who transforms and does the impossible. Lord, I'm so thankful that in Romans chapter 8, verse 28, you said, and God causes all things to work together for the good of those that love God and those who are called according to his purposes. So, God, I pray for each person, and whatever your need is this morning, whether you're here in person, in our parking lot, you're watching us online, whatever your need is, I want you to cry out to God. I want you to say, Lord, I decree in the name of Jesus that I am healed. That the cancer is gone, and that God, that whatever it is, I'm healed. My body is healed because of the strength of Jesus. That my financial needs, that God, you would supply me. Decree the word of God over those areas of your life and watch what he does. Watch what he does. pray, Father, faith would rise up in every single person today. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, and if you're here today, you're watching us online, one of the truths that makes all of this available is our relationship with God. If you are not in a relationship with God, I'm going to close in a prayer, and you can join me with this prayer, and you too can enter into a relationship with our Heavenly Father. And this is the prayer by saying, Father God in heaven, I thank you for the cross. I thank you for Jesus. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I ask Jesus to come into my life and into my heart. And I will follow you all the days of my life. And fill me with your Holy Spirit. For this moment today, I confess and declare that Jesus is my Lord. I pray that in Jesus' name. And Father, I pray for anyone today that may have said that prayer, the Father, that your Holy Spirit would bear witness with their spirit what they have done. I also pray, Father, for every single person as we are all different, so are the struggles we go through each and every day. Each fear is different. A fear that one person fears is not what another person fears. But Father, you know them all. And I bind the spirit of fear in our lives. Father, I pray that faith would rise up and we would stand upon the established word of God. Father, as we get ready to leave this place and to say goodbye at this moment, Father, I pray that you would just work through our lives and Father, meet us at our point of needs. And we will give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. And everyone said amen and amen. I want to thank you so much for coming. I want to thank the worship team. They did an amazing job leading us in worship. They have over the past little while. Have a great day. Let's remember the guidelines. Masks are to be worn. Please don't congregate in the lobby at this time. These restrictions will be lifted down the road, and we just have to kind of hang in there until they are done. And that, let's be patient just a little longer. We've been in this a while. Let's be patient a little bit longer in that. But God bless you. We'll see you next week. Have a great week. If you need prayer, we are here. We'd love the opportunity to pray with you. But God bless you and have a great day. Bye for now.